If you have to ask a question, you don't want to record it, change your voice, or have someone else ask it, or throw it down on the paper right now. But by staying where you are, you're giving your asset to be recorded. Hopefully, you'll have something that'll be noteworthy as on Reddit or YouTube for being hilarious. Before we start, how many of you are strictly database administrators? Anyone in here? Linux admins? You did nothing with Linux admin. How many of you are kind of like, you do everything at work, network, tables, you do lots and lots of car, you figured out to put that into your job description without being there? Many years ago, I was working at a university and I switched from the data processing side where you had a deck KS2020 with 36-bit words, 284 K words of memory, supporting roughly 30 users at any one time, the academic side, to get access to newer machines on campus, which were mainly VAXes, running VAX VMS. And we also had mobile versus E-box that converted over to Ultrix because I was falling in love with the idea of Unix. We also were donated a Pyramid P90 Exatron Berkeley Unix, and AT&T gave us some of the 3v2 machines. And then one of those career-limiting moves that happens too often to the data professional community back in the 70s, 80s, and 90s. Digital Equipment Corporation decided to kill off all their old operating systems. And I realized quite quickly that I painted myself in the corner. I had a friend whose dad was the last systems engineer programmer on the West Coast for Singer computers, Singer sewing machines and computers, RCA computers, and at the time he was working for NCR, which was making computers, but slowly going out of that business. So I was looking for an operating system that wouldn't disappear. And about the time I was really heavily into Berkeley Unix, there was a guy from Europe who wrote an operating system called Minix that was really good, but you either had to buy his book with his floppies, which was like 25 final quarter floppies to load it all, or if you were cheap, you could actually hand type in all that stuff because there was no way to download it off the internet, because the internet per se did not exist. Or you've heard about this crazy Finnish kid named Liz Torvalds who's giving away a Unix work light. And that's how I got into using Linux. And this is the talk. Kind of a pep talk for folks who aren't DBAs but also have DBA tasks put into their job title. I know many of you have very thin experience with databases, but you have not a lot of experience in everything else. So hopefully this is a little pep talk to keep you going through what you run into with databases. My name is Dave Stokes. I'm a MySQL community manager. I've been programming since the late 1970s, which is a hell of a long time. When we started with Fortran on punch cards, talking to a dead KL1091 that ran TOPS 10. As I mentioned earlier, I got forced to Unix, System 5 and BSD, and eventually Linux, after all my other operating systems were essentially killed off. And I've actually written a book on using the MySQL JSON data type. So if you look at our documentation that like it, you want a lot of quick, clear, concise examples. Amazon usually runs an electronic version sale once a month for about 10 bucks a copy. Hope it's well worth it. By the way, if you haven't heard of MySQL, it's roughly 25 years old. Old timers prefer to pronounce MySQL or MySQL, it doesn't really matter. Oracle's owned us for 10 years, and in that time we've roughly quadrupled our number of staff, including greatly ramped up engineering staff. And 8.0.17 is our latest release. 8.0.18 is our new release that will come out in about 2 months. We're trying to do quarterly cycles. We've got the CI like everyone else. So, what are databases? Well, I can go into the COD model, relational model, all that. But from your viewpoint, databases are selfish. They run best on a system all to themselves. They don't play well with it. They're messy. They chew up disk space. They chew up all sorts of other stuff. They grab memory like you wouldn't believe. Also, it needs a lot of bandwidth, and they also will take your sanity if you're not careful. And databases are growing all the time, and they will suck up a good part of your life as a Linux app. So basically, databases are the toddlers of the software world. If you're not a parent, take a look at these pictures. Basically, this is the personification of a database in toddler form. So, big disclaimer, that last slide was my opinion of databases of the toddlers in the software world. If you move from being a Linux admin and go into parts of management, you will also realize it's true. A lot of companies don't really plan their database environment enough, and they end up sticking it with someone who has other responsibilities, and they end up being shocked that among all your other duties, you don't have time to fully commit to babysitting a database. So, what makes a happy MySQL database? Well, we're going to talk about all these subjects here and cover them briefly, but it's a good introduction to the topic. Hardware. I don't know what your hardware budget cycle is. Some companies, it's yearly. Sometimes it's by project. Sometimes it's as other things already catch fire and they need to replace it. They'll actually fork over more money for hardware. What I recommend is that you spend your money on memory. Databases love memory. If you can have your entire working set of data in memory, it's going to be much, much, much faster. Also, get good memory. The stuff that you get on sale at Fry's or Best Buy may be consumer grade, it will be commercial grade, and it's not designed to be as rugged. Second comes cores. Databases love cores. MySQL, you can actually dedicate certain cores to certain batch, groups of queries. So if you have a low priority batch queue that you want to dedicate two CPUs out of 16 on your processor, you can do that. Why memory? Well, as I mentioned earlier, if you have your entire working set in memory, it doesn't have to do fetches off disk. Well, why is that important? Reading from memory is 100,000 times faster than reading from disk. If I could do a backflip a second and do 100,000 backflips, you could come back in the late next month and I'll almost be finished. By the way, 100,000 miles is 4 times around the Earth. 100,000 days is 273 years. 100,000 seconds is 27 hours. So 100,000 is a lot. I know these days you tend to hear big numbers and it's kind of lower us that we don't really think about. Disk drives. This is an area that's been really changing a lot in the last 5 years, and for the hardware vendors, it's going to change a lot in the next several years. If you can move your data to separate disks and separate controllers, also separate it from your logs. Do not log on slow devices. In many cases, MySQL will actually wait for the log to be written out before it proceeds. Recommend reading your hard drives to your favorite level. Mine's level 10. By the way, once you do this means you have to spend some time or get a piece of software that spends some time watching your system logs or doing dmessage to make sure that your drives don't go bad. Last year, I got a very nice steak dinner out of a company that said, hey, our database is running slow. Could you come over and take a look at it? I walked into their office, and their computer room was visible behind the receptionist, and I noticed the RAID array had a bunch of flashing red lights. So before even sitting down, I said, have you run dmessage to see how the status of your disk array? Oh my God, he's brilliant. He hasn't even sat down on Turbo. He tells us we're on the database. Once again, do not use consumer-grade disks. Stuff once again you can buy Fry's or Best Buy are designed for home computer that's powered up maybe 8 or 10 hours a week. They're not designed for 724/365. Also, very carefully look at the caches, the disk and controller caches. There are two types. Write through, which when you send the data to it, automatically push it through to the next device. Or write back basically says, yeah, I got it, and then later pushes it through. The trouble with both these types is they both lie to you. It's possible to lose data with both. Also, a lot of controllers have an auto-tune cycle, or a true period, where it learns the flow of the data. If this runs during production, it can be hours, it will slow you down. It often turns off caching. It does other little things for you. So if you can turn that off, please do. By the way, much, much, much faster drives around the way.
I ask your opinion on solid-state drives. I mean, one of my biggest worries with them is that there's certain areas that over time wear out, you don't want to write to them anymore. Have you seen any big improvements there for this kind of enterprise level class?
As the generations have gone on, we're basically now on the third generation solid-state drives. They've gotten a lot better, but they're designed to be consumable commodities. So if you need 5 by 10, stick 5 away, and you know, just plan for the day where you have to pop them. They are getting a little bit better, but it's one of those things where they're consumable. Okay, so what does all that disk space mean if you're on the cloud? Well, you got to be careful. One thing I recommend that you do if you're talking to a cloud provider, Amazon, Oracle, Google, or whomever, is print out that SLA, grab a cup of coffee, and get away from work and go through it line by line to see what their obligations are, what your obligations are. Had a big customer near me walk away from setting up a big cloud shop because they were basically offered a 3-hour turnaround for a complete outage. They supply medical information to hospitals. 3 hours is much too long of a window. And then their lawyer pointed out to them that a lot of the HIPAA information they had could not be taken off premise. So double check your SLA that the cloud companies want to give you and the SLA you have to your customers. Network. Never expose your database instances to the outside world unless you like restoring and rebuilding them on a regular basis. Scrub any user data you get in. If it comes from a bank giving you credit rates and you're going to do an ETL process on that, scrub it good. If you have a web application and your people are putting in information, make sure that if they're supposed to give you an integer, that's an integer. If they're a string of 30 characters, it's a string of 30 characters and not a 1500 character JavaScript exploit. Do not trust anything your users give you without filtering somehow. And if you can't filter it somehow, quarantine it off so it doesn't get acted on directly. Also, I like to tell people, keep a separate network for replication and or backups. Networking gear is very, very cheap these days, and it's easier to have that not be a point of contention. Other big thing, the MySQL authentication process is promiscuous. What do I mean by that? Well, when you connect using either of the two MySQL protocols to a server, the first thing the server asks is this packet I'm getting from a system that's allowed to connect to me? If not, disconnect. Is it basically, it's a whitelisting. Is the user who's trying to connect from that IP address allowed to talk to me? Is that person in the MySQL user table? Hopefully you don't have anonymous accounts. Anonymous accounts are where there's no value or wildcard value in the user column. Is there some other restriction on that user? Sometimes you have users who can only get in between 9 and 5. You might have resource limits where they're only allowed to do 10,000 queries a week. If that restrictions aren't okay, we go on to the next step. Do they have a password and or authentication string? We changed the password column to authentication string because we're doing a whole bunch of different types of authentication passwords now. So if you're allowed on the machine, and you have a valid account, and you have a valid authentication string, it's going to let you in. Now, the trouble with this is it's not easy to fool. So if your boss is coming in from your subnet, 192, 168, whatever, and they have a set of privileges, and then they get home and they call in, and they have another account that's at the home network, Those could be two separate accounts. They may not have the same privileges. And the only way you find this out is you get a phone call on a Friday night when you've had a couple of beers and you're nice and relaxed. Your boss says, hey, I was doing employee reviews and I can't get this piece of information. What's wrong with you? Also, I'll repeat this later. I usually tell people do not do host lookups by name. Do it by IP addresses. Why? If you've been a long-time administrator on a network and you haven't had a bad zone transfer of DNS information, you haven't had a fun life. Basically, everything you do is not getting out until you basically reboot everything from cold. If it doesn't have to go out and do that hop to a server to authenticate the DNS information, it just knows the IP address, it goes much faster. Replication servers. MySQL replication has been around since the early days of MySQL, and it's been a very handy feature for two reasons. One is you can split read and write operations to give you better throughput. Also, it's real nice to use replication for backup purposes. We have two main types of asynchronous replication. Async, basically, the slave machine gets a copy of the transactions done on the master and applies those changes to its copy of the data. Semi-synchronous is like that. The only difference is it sends a notice back to the master saying, you can go ahead and keep going. I've got this information. I may not have written out to this, but I actually have received this information. So we're good to go. Now, replication servers do more work in a shorter period of time, so I usually tell people make sure there's slightly better hardware if possible. There's also MySQL utilities out there to help you clone servers instead of replication. And once again, if you can, use a dedicated network to avoid other network contention. Now, in the past 2 years, we've added MySQL group replication. The idea is that your applications shouldn't have to know the mechanics of what's going on behind the database connection. It shouldn't know it's talking to one server or 100 servers. It should just talk to one instance, one entity that takes care of all the information. Group replication is real simple. Your application talks to a router, MySQL router, proxy, SQL, or something similar. Your application isn't dependent on information down here. In this case, we have a read, write, read-only split, where we have two read-only instances and one read-write. Group replication, if one of those boxes goes away, another box will take over for it. We also have active-active master-master replication, so if you don't want to do the splitting, you want to have all these boxes to be active masters, you can. Big hint on software. Run the latest, greatest version of MySQL that you can. Until fairly recently, I'd go to shops and they're running the latest version of the Linux kernel. They're running the latest version of whatever programming their programming language they like. They're running the latest version of JavaScript. They have all the latest frameworks, but they're stuck on MySQL 5.1. Well, you're missing a lot of performance and a lot of bug fixes. Also, there's a lot of features we've added in the past several years that make it worthwhile to upgrade. And also, the big reason is security. As we find vulnerabilities, we take care of them. But if you're running on a piece of software that's 8 years old, that's not going to be our highest priority to get fixed. Also, try to keep your MySQL instances by themselves. As the top example pointed out, databases do not play well with others. MySQL will contend for resources, and if you're doing something like an LDAP server and a database server on the same box, you'll find someone come one day, walk in, and find out that everything's swapping. Not a happy experience. You might have a caching layer with a MySQL server, but depends on how your architecture works. Big trouble with that is that the database and the caching layer will actually chew up memory and contend for each other. Something else I want to point out to you, everyone's database evolves. What happens if Monday you walk in and there's your corporate counsel and your CFO and your CTO, and they say, hey, we had a problem 2 years ago we just found out about. Could you restore a server, the database server, to what it looked like 2 years ago? Application, data, middleware. It's it's an edge case, but I've run into four companies in the past 4 months that have had this issue, and it's something you need to be aware of. Make sure you archive things off when you do upgrades, and make sure that you know how to get them running. Leave dedicated notes. Once again, proxies are great. MySQL is an ODB cluster, uses MySQL router or proxy SQL. In this case, it's running the three masters. And this gives you high availability, allows you to scale masters at build. We had a new cloning feature that came out with 8.0.17 2 weeks ago. When a new server comes up, it even has the option of copying everything over from a table, basically line by line, or copying the underlying ODB table space in a cloning function. Cloning works much faster. If you're playing with containers, we had trouble early on with Docker. We had our official MySQL Docker image, and Docker had the official Docker MySQL Docker image. Our engineers met with their engineers, and we fixed that. So when you're pulling something from Docker, the image you're getting now is supported by MySQL engineers. Backups and replications. This is going to be the bane of your existence. Thou shalt make backups. Make sure you back up your data so frequently that it almost becomes painful, and then look for another way to increase that. Why? The big question becomes, it should actually be, how long can one piece of information go missing before things get critical? If you lose one customer's order for a bag of M&Ms, that's not as critical. If you're Boeing and you lose one customer's order for a 787, it's a little more financial impact. Also, make sure that you and your staff knows how to restore an entire MySQL instance, a table, a row. These sound like different things, and there's slight variations of the theme, but there are times when you don't want all 800,000 customers out there, you just want that one record. Make sure that you and someone else that you have on your staff know how to do that and document it well. Cross-train. Also, keep copies of your backup off-site and test them randomly. Roll a 16-sided dice and grab a backup from X months back and go back and read it. A friend of mine was doing backups on a DVD device, and they were asked to pull something back from 6 months before, and they couldn't read it. Well, was it bad media? Was it a bad write? No, they forgot that the hardware vendor had come in and changed out that drive. New drive doesn't read the old format. Therefore, they had years of legal data they couldn't read. Replication. I got into this a little bit earlier. Asynchronous, where we grab a copy of the changes on one machine and apply it to a copy of the data on another one. Semi-sync, where it grabs copies of that information, but the master holds on and doesn't make changes until it gets told that, yes, we have a copy of it. Now, this is all single-threaded before MySQL 5.6. They got multi-threaded for different databases in 5.6, and multi-threaded within a database in 5.7. So if you're running 5.7 and you're changing the same table but in different parts of it, it is multi-threaded and goes through. If you need to do better than that, I highly recommend it. Take a look at proof replication, which you also call an ODB cluster. If you're running async or semi-synchronous, you do not need to replicate everything. Replicate the very critical stuff. Do backups on a regular basis of the stuff that's not critical. It depends on the churn of your data. Sometimes one backup day is enough. Sometimes if you're doing more intense stuff, it's going to be more frequently. Sometimes it's not going to be as frequently as all. You can also filter the tables. You don't have to take all the tables out of a database to replicate them over. By the way, you can also change on the fly, starting with 5.7, the filters. So if something starts asking flaky or you're worried about something, without having to bring down the servers or restart replication, you can actually change it from having just a couple tables to everything in the instance with no problem. Something we introduced in global in MySQL 5.6 and kept on 5.7 and 8.0 is global transaction IDs. In the past, if you're doing MySQL replication, what you do is you have your master box and you pause it, make a backup, copy that over to the slave server. And then you say, okay, slave server, go back to this point in the log files and start writing from that point. And that had to be a manual process. There's no way to automate that. So what we've done is we've added an unique ID to each transaction. So when a new slave server hooks up on the network, it says, okay, I know about transaction 5678. Please give me everything cast 5678. So it starts getting 5679 and all that. Saves time, saves sanity. It's easier, well, much easier to automate. We've also been adding reputation data into the database rather than keeping that out into stub files out on the disk platter. Makes it a lot easier and makes it more crash safe. Something else you can do, ooh, I'll just grab this little alert. So, master server, database, the log has changed. The slave machine attaches to the master, gets a copy of that log, copies it over into the relay log, and then applies it to the database. If you turn off this channel right here, it still grabs changes from the master, and you can do backups on the database data. And then when you're done with the backup, you turn this back on, and all the stuff in the relay log gets replayed, and your database is backed up safely, and you still have two copies of it. Now, group replication is a little different. This is multi-primary mode, where we have things set up, write clients and read clients, and pretend that S1 goes bad. The write clients don't get a negative response from their write, and the cluster will automatically reconfigure one of the other boxes to take over. By the way, you can set up, you don't need any cluster, in a sandbox or otherwise in about 8 commands in under 5 minutes. If you're in a big Oracle database shop, you also might be able to piggyback off their big STD backup devices. By the way, MySQL also works with Oracle Autocall, Database Firewall, Key Manager. So if you're in a big Oracle shop, make friends with your Oracle DBA and see if you can leverage off some of their stuff. Tools make life easier. Monitoring. Yes, you need to monitor. Why? We'll get a call 3 o'clock in the morning. Why is everything slow at 3 o'clock in the morning? I don't know. What are you doing on the server at 3 o'clock in the morning? Well, I thought I'd come in and think it should be slow, but something's gone to hell. What's going on? And you know the backup should have been done an hour before. So you need something that goes out there and monitor. Now, there are command line tools, GUI tools, and all sorts of stuff that you can use, and I'll get into that a little bit. But you need to have something that watches your database when you're not watching it, because there are things that will pop up that you won't catch or you won't notice, and you want to make sure that you somehow raise your awareness of them. Now, for active monitor, the one I recommend is MySQL Enterprise Monitor. This works with the community division, the community edition, which is a free version that most of you probably use. This comes with a support contract, and will track vulnerable instances and alert you to when changes are going on. It also lets you look at performance windows and dig tunnel down to see what queries are running at the same time. Proponer Monitor is another interesting tool. A little bit older are various modules for Nagios and Cacti. You might have your favorite tool for monitoring MySQL. I'm not going to mention them, but if you want to, you can later in Q&A. Now, what you want is to be able to comb through historical data. Why do things slow down greatly Friday at 4:55 p.m.? What's going on? What impacts the backups running at 3 o'clock at night have? Now, there are also some active tools like MySQL Workbench, which is a tool that runs on Linux, Macs, Windows, and source available for it also. Use that to connect to your instance, and it will give you kind of as connected, look at what the performance is. So you can get reports on which queries are running without an index, which index has never been used, who's hogging your I.O. you know, what's your bit rate on your various tables, what's your caching rate. It gives you a lot of interesting information, so you can find out instantaneously what's going on. But it doesn't give you historical information. To a lesser extent, PHP MyAdmin is very popular. I don't like it as much because most of the script kiddies realize you have PHP MyAdmin out there, that's a vector for them to attack. Once again, Workbench is an interesting tool. One of the things I like is Visual Explain to figure out the query performance of a query plan within a within one of your schemas. It's also a great admin tool. You can do backups, you can do restores, you can add users and all that. The best thing there is you're no longer going through and typing on the command line, update user, username, select prev equals, uppercase Y, update prev, uppercase Y, delete underscore prev, and giving you 18 prevs. Obviously, it has a great dashboard. It also has an entity relationship mapper, which helps you document what your database is doing, where the various keys go between the tables, so you know what your foreign key relations are. It's a great migration tool, so if you have something running in SQL Server or Sybase and need to port it over, it's very handy way to do that. And by the way, it's free. We also have a new shell. The new shell came about because our old protocol is now getting close to 30 years old, and there's a lot of things that we wanted to do we couldn't do with the protocol. The new shell has command completion, has a wonderful help function, but most notably it has three modes, Python, JavaScript, and good old SQL. So if you have a library that you want to use for some sort of ETL or data massaging before you can bring data into the database or out of the database, you can do that. It's also the admin tool for NoDB cluster. It also has a built-in upgrade checker, so if you're on 5.7, you want to know what you need to change before you go to 8.0. Check for upgrade, you give it the host IP, and it will tell you explicitly if you have any reserved words being used that shouldn't be used, what type of characters that correlation problems you're going to have, whether you have any foreign keys or you're selling your B2R, actually there isn't now used to have any before. It also has a bulk loader that works in parallel for JSON, CSV, and TSV data. And we're adding more reports and scripts to it to give you more features. So if you're used to running something like InnoTop, to see how your NoDB instances are running, or storage units are running, we're going to add into there. And there's other tools out there, most notably Proponent Toolkit. They have a lot of interesting little utilities out there for day-to-day work. If you're from an old Oracle shop and you're used to using code, it's out there. This is a query tool, very popular with old-timers. Now, once again, you might have your own favorite tool to go out there to work with MySQL. Config settings. Once again, turn off DNS lookup. The extra hop going out to your DNS server and saying, tell me who foo.com is, and wait for it to come back, slows down your queries. Also, save and load statistics. Your database is very much like a GPS. It wants to get data the cheapest way possible. And to do that, it has a bunch of historical information. And much like a GPS, if things are changing rather rapidly, it may not know about it. So if you want to go to the Cowtown Museum and you know the way, hey, that's great. But if you don't know the way, or you don't know there's a road closure or a parade or some sort of accident on the way, you can't get there the way you want to. The way the database works is it wants statistics on how to get to all these places. So if you use persistent statistics and you make sure you set it on that they get dumped every time the server goes down and that startup data be read, your server knows how to get that information. It doesn't have to run for a while to be able to figure out how to get things quickly and efficiently. Also use set persist. This came out in MySQL 8.0. How many of you are working in a cloud environment and have more than one admin on your cloud instances? Okay. Well, if you don't, when you do, what happens? I make a change on Monday. He makes a change on Tuesday. She makes one on Thursday. Amazon goes to hell on Sunday. We come back, it's rebooted. The changes I made, he made, she made are not there. And things are running poorly, so we're not quite sure. If you set persist before you change your global variable, it actually records in the logs with the timestamp who and when they made the change. And it also has a local configuration file where it records those changes. So that as the server comes back up, it will go out there and take those recorded changes and feed it into your server. You can also tune your log level. I usually tell people run with the lowest level you feel comfortable with. But the trouble is you have to spend some time going out and taking a look at that. And when things get bad, you can ramp it up. So if you just want errors, you can record that. Something starts going wrong, you get errors and warnings, and then you can add to errors, warnings, and notes. By the way, if you have a special syslog process that you like, you can now send your output from MySQL instance to syslog. Also something I recommend, if you're running 5.6 or before, get ready to get rid of your query cache. Query cache was handy in the early days when you were running the same query over and over and over again. What would happen, the often left would see a query, make a hash of it, compare that hash to known well-run queries before, and it would actually save the query plan out there. Big trouble with that is that it was single-threaded and it chewed up a lot of memory. So if you had 100 people all trying to run different queries, they'd all have to go through the same bottleneck to run through the query cache. So we turned that off by default. If you're running the same query over and over again, the exact same query, either cache that information in a caching layer or put it somewhere in your application and update it as you need it. The other big recommendation I make is when you get a new box, set the NVMe buffer pool size equals 75 to 80% physical RAM, and go with that. The databases are getting better at self-tuning. You might have seen Oracle's big splash about fully autonomous databases that do all the tuning by themselves. In the past, a Oracle DBA would occasionally go out there and unlock a query plan and optimize it and relock it. MySQL wants to optimize every query every time it sees it. But from that, a lot of AI work, we're getting better heuristics within the server to be able to self-tune on the fly. Something else that we've added in 8.0 are histograms. Indexes are the fast way to get to data if it's indexed. The only trouble is indexes have a lot of maintenance. So if you're doing an update, a delete, or modification, that's overhead, and it's actually a separate table that has to be maintained. Histograms are different. Basically, what you do is you run an alter table command to add histogram to your information. Then it goes out, and this is a singleton version of the information. We also have equal buckets, where you have equal number of buckets, you divide it by the data by the number of buckets. So if we know that this information is divided up into these six variables, this is our cardinality, we can actually tell the optimizer to use the histogram to make it much faster to find the 33s or the 34s. Now, this is for data that doesn't have a lot of churn. You have to occasionally run all the table on it to update it. But if you have a lot of statistical data that doesn't change on a regular basis, this is a good way to go to get away from the overhead of indexes. Okay, some big hints. As an administrator, be damn stingy with permissions and grants. Everyone you've heard about this. Either you copy someone else's account and give it to another person and they don't have the brains of the first person and they end up deleting stuff or ruining stuff somehow. So don't give away privileges. You don't have to. It's easier to say no than constantly be restoring your data. Also, in their configuration file or on their login profile, use safe updates or IAM a dummy. What this does is it limits the number of records that you return or delete. And if you're using a query without a where clause, it will not run. So if they accidentally type, they mean to type delete from user where ID equals 15, and they forget to type in the where from the user of 14, they're not going to put in the delete user. So they're not going to wipe out everything. Sysschema. This is something we started adding about MySQL 5.5. This is metadata about the operations of your server. When it first came out, we had a lot of critics saying, oh my god, this is an extra overhead on the server, this is horrible, this is degrading from our performance, and we'll turn it off. Well, the good news about this is now we have 2.5% overall overhead on the server, and gives you a lot of viable, interesting information. Who's hogging your resources? Which indexes aren't being used? Which queries are causing problems? Now, those stuff is a pain in the ass. And if you don't have this turned on, you're going to spend 10 times as much time trying to track down the problems if you have sysschemas or not. Security. Your bosses are really buying security right now. From MySQL 5.7 onward, we have forced you to set a root password. In the past, depending on where you were, you might have been upgraded, you might have your password and give you an anonymous password on it. Don't do that anymore. Also, we do not force a test DB out there for you. So if you didn't upgrade, especially in the cloud, and someone realized it, they can go in anonymously, get your test database, and divulge and ask stuff before you ever lock it down. By the way, in the past, after you did an upgrade, you usually ran MySQL_upgrade to change the metadata underneath. That, as of 8.0.16, has gone away. It's automatically done for you. Also, we support password rotation. So if your company says rotate passwords every 90 days, make sure it has at least one uppercase, one lowercase, and one special character. However you want to do that, we support that, or you turn it off. Another big hint, if you're going from 5.7 to 8.0, fire up our new shell, and you don't check for server upgrade, root of localhost at the proper port. It does a lot of checks, checks for conflicting keywords. If you're using the old UTF-MP3 key character set, if you're using zero fill, a whole bunch of other issues. It's better to fight these battles before you do the upgrade, know that you have to do it, rather than have to find out that you, after the upgrade, things are going on in production. So websites, a note, it helps take a look at. Forums.mysql.com, this is our monitor by our engineers. So if you have a question about NODB replication, our new FDIP API, licensing, I think we have like 38 subwords on there. And we also have subwords in various languages like German, Portuguese, Spanish, Chinese. Second on that was planetmysql.com. That's a blog aggregator, and it runs the gamut from people teaching basics of SQL to our engineers talking about the new features in the optimizer and in between. And it collects for everybody. It collects from MariaDB, Percona, Booking.com, Google, Facebook, everyone else. And lastly, check out devmysql.com. As I mentioned, we've gone into a continuous integration process so that every 3 months you're going to see a new version of MySQL. And with that, I'd like to point out that you can download the slide deck if you want, and there's other contact. So what questions do you have? Well, if you have a question, I'll be around all day. If something pops into your head 3 weeks from now, please contact me. I'm fairly easy to track down. And with that, thank you all for coming out, and have safe travels home. What's the thing when I travel for my wife? I said, no, I can't be afraid.
website is the year 2000, believe it or not.
I had a friend in 2011 built an instance of OpenVMS in the contract.
Yeah, DoDoA.
Yeah.
The fun part was the guy that was in charge of maintaining and supporting that was begging me to stop paying literally anything to get rid of that on strong. And of course, we moved to Deck Alpha when we were against us.
Yeah.
Well, that was common.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the port was pretty easy at that point. Of course, no kidding, room size ever would be best.
I was looking for Xerox, and we had an old 785 that we basically had the same software running on microboxes that that Xerox was selling. And one of our engineers said, how should I get rid of your 785 and get two of these to replace it? So they said, yeah, let's do that. So one Friday, we shut down 785, yanked out all the hardware, put in these two microboxes, and everything came up, everything's great, and we was able to log in, come in Saturday morning, make sure everything's still running, and computer windows across the border.
Oh, I'm kidding.
We forgot to turn to the thermostat for the lock of the AP generators.
Right, yeah.
And the floor was like a skating rink, it's like,
Yeah, I remember we had two air handlers in that room for that, in case one went down. One could support the level alone.
Well, one of my deck field engineers, who's in the Ocean Systems Center in Portland, California, to do maintenance on machine. So these are pedals that were hollowed out during World War II. Mm-hmm. And they stopped plastic processing, and chased you around outside the room, so we're going to lock you in here. So he gets in there and closes the door, and it's like a refrigerator. So as soon as they're in the room, I can, and that door shut, all that's what happened. And he said, you never do a claustrophobia into the room. It's just like banging on the door. Of course, it takes him 2 minutes, though.
Those locks, yeah.
That's when Scott's are asking your hardware service guy, why are you retiring?
Yeah, I
don't want to do this before.
Yeah, I don't know, they said they were paying $250,000 a year just licensing to keep that back alive. I mean, because nobody else is doing the software, so the license costs just skyrocket.
Yeah.
To keep somebody on staff to support that product, that should have gone away.
Well, 10 years ago, the first time I went to the Scale conference out in Los Angeles, they had a bunch of guys who worked for DEC who were looking for familiar faces because they still had customers waiting months in the database for guys who were minting. And they're offering outrageous amounts of money to work for them for a year.
Okay. So, yeah, DoD's medical database that stored literally all the patient data and stuff on the CUS and combined monitoring system, that was the Calvax.
Yeah.
It kept running after mid late 2000s. I don't remember exactly how they got it.
Well, 5 years ago, they made 5 year labor who got a phone call. This is Department of Commerce, and it's co-op with the I'm retired. We'll take this down. I'll be. So he went to the Wolf University.